Amid the collapse, wars, and disintegration of Yugoslavia from 1991 to 1999, the Bosnian Serb Army, the VRS, launched an offensive and took over the UN safe area of Srebrenica on July 11, 1995, despite UN Security Council Resolution 819, which stated that the enclave should be free from any armed attack or any other hostile act. In April 1992, Serb paramilitary groups took control of Srebrenica, a predominantly Bosniak-inhabited city, close to Bosnia's eastern border with Serbia. A month later, the Army of the Republic of Bosnia and Herzegovina retook control of the town. In 1993, Bosnian Serb forces launched an offensive to take over the areas around Srebrenica. Swollen with refugees, the town's population increased from its pre-war 27,000 inhabitants to 60,000. On April 16, 1993, the UN Security Council declared Srebrenica and its surroundings a safe area, protected by lightly armed UN peacekeepers. In June 1993, the UN Security Council expanded UNPROFOR's mandate to deter attacks on the besieged enclave and, in support, authorized the use of air power. The strategy of the Bosnian Serb authorities was to render the enclaves unsustainable by limiting supplies of fuel, ammunition, and food to UN peacekeepers, which undermined their ability to effectively carry out their duties to the safe areas. The UN forces' food, medicine, fuel, and ammunition reserves began to run dangerously low. The Bosnian Serb army were given approval to create an unbearable situation of total insecurity with no hope of further survival or life for the inhabitants of Srebrenica. Directive 7.1 recommended that the Drina Corps of the Bosnian Serb army conduct active combat operations.
The language in this widely distributed military order is shocking in its own right, but it is also remarkable for its similarity to words used in the Genocide Convention of 1948 to identify the third of five acts that can constitute genocide, namely, deliberately inflicting on the group conditions of life calculated to bring about its physical destruction in whole or in part, end quote.
The Drina Corps launched a military operation against the safe area of Srebrenica. On June 3, Dutch UN soldiers at the observation post Echo were forced to leave their position. I insist that we will never use force and impose our will on the Serbs. If we hit them, they will be more cooperative. We must defer to General Janvier as senior commander. The 3,000 soldiers from three Drina Corps brigades were equipped with tanks, armored vehicles, multiple rocket launchers, artillery pieces, anti-aircraft guns, and mortars. When the Bosnian Serb forces began their attack on Srebrenica, General Mladic knew that the UN forces numbered 450, that they were lightly armed, and that this was a crucial moment as they lacked air support. The Army of the Republic of Bosnia and Herzegovina requested that the UN battalion commander return them the weapons that were surrendered as part of the 1993 demilitarization agreements. The request was refused. Dutch battalion headquarters declared a state of red alert. The position of UNPROFOR soldiers in the enclave worsened by the day. Bosnian Serb Army General Krstic must have known the Bosnian Serb Army military actions against Srebrenica were calculated to spark a humanitarian crisis that would later lead to the elimination of the enclave and force the Srebrenica inhabitants into fleeing the town and seeking protection at the Dutch battalion headquarters in Potocari. Carl Bildt urged the Bosnian Serbs to refrain from military actions in order to give the political negotiations a chance. The Bosnian Serb army had been shelling populated civilian areas of Srebrenica and openly and deliberately attacking the positions of UNPROFOR and the Army of the Republic of Bosnia and Herzegovina.
Et en 2001, le rapport de la commission d'enquête parlementaire française qui a enquêté sur Srebrenica et qui souligne que les États et notamment les grandes puissances en 95 ont fait le choix de, je cite, de simplifier la négociation diplomatique en clarifiant la carte ethnique de la Bosnie-Herzégovine et de conclure aucun des États impliqués dans le règlement du conflit bosnien n'a voulu sauver Srebrenica sans qu'existe pour autant de conspiration.
The Dutch battalion commander requested close air support in response to an attack on observation post Foxtrot, but his request was denied. UNPROFOR officials in Sarajevo and Zagreb also believed the Bosnian Serb army did not intend to overrun the entire enclave, but only to take control of strategic areas in its southern part. Bosnian Serb army soldiers, upon entering the UN observation post Foxtrot, ordered its crew to abandon the post and surrender their arms. The Bosnian Serb army took UN observation post uniform. Observation posts Foxtrot and uniform had fallen. The situation had grown very tense. At no point during that meeting was there any discussion about the ongoing Bosnian Serb army attack on Srebrenica, nor was there any assessment made that they were planning to overrun the enclaves. The meeting concluded with a sense that if there were no breakthroughs on the peacemaking front in the immediate future, the UN would have to consider withdrawing from Bosnia. The UNPROFOR commander insisted that the UN soldiers being held in Bratunac should be allowed to return to Potočari. General Tolimir responded that he would convey the proposal to his subordinates on the ground. The estimated 3,000 residents of the Swedish shelter project, located near the southern perimeter of the enclave, began fleeing towards Srebrenica town. The Bosnian Serb army began to attack UN observation post Kilo in the south of the enclave. The UNPROFOR commander's chief of staff expressed that he considered this to be an attack on the safe area and said that UNPROFOR would be forced to defend it with all means. It was decided that the Dutch battalion should establish a blocking position against the Bosnian Serb army forces' approach to the town. In connection with this, the acting UN commander in Sarajevo forwarded to the UNPROFOR command in Zagreb a written request for close air support. The UNPROFOR commander's chief of staff demanded that the Bosnian Serb army offensive on Srebrenica be stopped, that the Bosnian Serb army withdraw to the enclave boundary, and that the Bosnian Serb army also immediately release all Dutch battalion personnel and their equipment.
Dans son rapport publié en 1999, l'ONU a écrit, je cite, la conséquence logique du dysfonctionnement de la force de l'ONU, du défaut structurel de son mandat et de la définition des zones de sécurité, ainsi que des manquements et des fautes des individus, principalement au sein de la chaîne militaire des Nations Unies, ont causé cette chute.
As the arrangements for the provision of close air support were being made, the Dutch battalion commander, who had earlier favoured its use, changed his assessment in view of the extent to which the Bosnian Serb army had now advanced.
Radovan Karadžić, who is also accused for genocide in Bosnia, did not hide his genocidal intent. There are many instances in which he shared his intent in conversation with his close allies. In October 1991, for example, he told to his brother that there will be a war until their obliteration, that his plan is to first kill all of the leaders of Bosnian Muslims.
Late on July 9, President Radovan Karadžić issued a new order giving the Drina Corps the green light to take the town of Srebrenica.
When we patrolled I would join two or three officers, not Dutch, you know, these were from various countries in the world. I joined them on those trips. And people would ask, you know, those people who lived around the observation posts, people would ask, I was translating from Bosnian into English, etc. And people would ask the question, you know, what would happen? What would happen if the Serbs launch an attack? And these observers would answer, well, they showed up to the sky. They said, well, you know, within 5, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, upon our call, you know, of United Nations, there would be NATO planes. You know, they would just fly from a NATO base in Italy, and it takes a few minutes to those mighty war machines to destroy any attacking force on the ground. You are safe. You are under the protection of United Nations and NATO.
As NATO planes began to circle over the area, the Bosnian Serb army stopped firing and the attack halted. That afternoon, the NATO planes left the area. As the planes left, the Bosnian Serb army continued firing on the Dutch as long as the UN blockades were not in the town itself. The Dutch still held Srebrenica, but the Bosnian Serb army held all the key positions and were ready to enter the town the following day. On one side, there were 370 soldiers in the Dutch battalion, and on the other, there were thousands of soldiers armed to the teeth. Even if we'd had three times as many peacekeepers, they wouldn't have been enough to stop the Serbs.
L'autorisation était avant entre les mains des militaires, commandants. À partir de fin mai jusqu'à fin juillet, l'autorisation des frappes est donnée aux dirigeants politiques de l'ONU. Les militaires, les commandants militaires de l'ONU en ex-Yougoslavie ne peuvent que recommander, mais ils ne peuvent pas signer l'autorisation des frappes. Cette mesure particulière est prise fin mai et elle est valable jusqu'à la conférence de Londres en juillet 1995.
The Dutch battalion commander again requested close air support. This was approved in Tuzla and Sarajevo and was passed to UNPROFOR headquarters in Zagreb. The aircraft for close air support were on standby and could be ready if called upon within 1 hour.
Je termine juste en citant le rapport Je cite juste le rapport pour que vous ne considériez pas que c'est une position personnelle non plus. La synthèse que j'ai pu faire sur le rôle de la communauté internationale, le rapport même de l'ONU estime que les États au sein du Conseil de sécurité du groupe de contact doivent accepter leur part de responsabilité pour avoir laissé se produire ces événements tragiques.
The special representative of the UN Secretary General, Yasushi Akashi, who was in Dubrovnik at that time, attempted to contact the President of Serbia, Slobodan Milosevic, unsuccessfully. Thousands of refugees were now in the town, and the population was panicking. The UNPROFOR commander said that the situation was impossible, and that he would do everything he could to avoid the use of force, but that there were limits.
En juin, le 4 juin 1993, par la résolution 836, cette protection est renforcée par l'autorisation du recours à la force. Et le texte précise qu'en riposte à des bombardements, par toute partie contre les zones de sécurité, toutes, hein, les six, pas simplement Srebrenica, mais également Srebrenica, en riposte donc à des bombardements, à des incursions armées, à des obstacles délibérés mis à l'intérieur de ces zones et dans leurs environs et à la liberté de circulation de la force de l'ONU. Dans ce cas-là, on peut faire appel à l'OTAN.
When the expected NATO air support failed to come, the Dutch battalion commander renewed his request twice, but to no avail. Lacking approval from the UNPROFOR High Command, NATO airplanes flying over Bosnia since 6 a.m. had to return to Italy for refueling. The Bosnian Serb army resumed their attack with direct fire on Dutch positions and began shelling observation posts Mike and November. The residents of Srebrenica began to flee northwards in the direction of the UN base in Potočari. The Bosnian Serb army radioed a message to the Dutch battalion and threatened to shell the town and the UN compound where thousands of inhabitants had begun to gather, and to kill the Dutch battalion soldiers held hostage since the capture of their observation posts if NATO continued with its use of air power. The Netherlands Minister of Defense requested that the close air support action be discontinued because Serb soldiers on the scene were too close to the Dutch troops. The message was passed to NATO accordingly, and the air action was halted. On July 11 and 12, 1995, the Srebrenica enclave was captured by the joint forces of the Bosnian Serb Army and the Ministry of Interior. The invading Serb forces took control of the town. General Ratko Mladic and other officers triumphantly entered Srebrenica and strolled through its empty streets.
Ratko Mladic is the general who is on trial for genocide in The Hague, and not only for genocide in Srebrenica, but in other municipalities as well. On May 12, 1992, after Krajišnik read those six strategic goals, Mladic warned both of them, Krajišnik and Karadžić, that this goal cannot be implemented without committing genocide. Do not have any illusions. Mladic did not have moral concerns about it. He was only worried how will Karadžić and Krajišnik explain that to the world, and what will the world say for their actions, and whether that would provoke military intervention.
United Nations military observers reported that upwards of 20,000 inhabitants, mainly women, children and the elderly, were converging on the Dutch battalion headquarters compound in Potočari. The Dutch battalion commander assessed that the main gate to the compound was vulnerable to Bosnian Serb army fire, and accordingly ordered that a hole be cut in the fence on the other side of the compound. Some 4,000 to 5,000 refugees had entered the compound through this hole by the early evening. The Dutch battalion did not have the provisions or space required to accommodate any more refugees and blocked entry into the compound for the additional refugees, estimated to number some 15,000 to 20,000, also comprised mainly of women, children and the elderly. Mladic summoned Dutch battalion commander Karemans for two evening meetings at Hotel Fontana. At the first meeting, Mladic warned him against the use of air power. At the second meeting later that night, Karemans returned with local Srebrenica representatives. Mladic asked them whether they wanted to survive or disappear.
Dovoljno je da kažete šta želite. I sinoć sam rekao, gospodin, možete opstati ili nestati.
At midnight on July 11, 15,000 Bosnian Muslim men decided they were no longer prepared to wait for death to arrive. Hiding in the woods outside Srebrenica, surrounded by Bosnian Serb military forces, a column of men set out on a perilous 63-mile journey through mountains and minefields to Tuzla. At the last meeting, held at noon on the next day, Mladic announced that the civilians would be expelled on buses provided by him, while all able-bodied men would be immediately separated and retained. The Dutch battalion commander responded that he had no diesel to provide the Bosnian Serb army with, and requested that he be allowed to put one of his soldiers on each of the buses evacuating the population. All available buses and vans belonging to the Bosnian Serb army must be made available to the Drina Corps command, which will provide specific instructions and locations for refueling. Lieutenant Colonel Popovic told me that the able-bodied Muslim men would be separated from the crowd, detained temporarily in Bratunac, and killed shortly thereafter. We discussed the appropriate locations to detain the Muslim men in prior to their execution. In the early morning, the Bosnian Serb army entered Potočari with 40 to 50 vehicles, including vans, trucks and small military vehicles, and took up tank and artillery positions surrounding the Dutch battalion compound. Television cameras filmed scenes of the soldiers handing out bread and water to the refugees. Mladic tossed out candy. A few hours later, the active campaign of terror started. Some were shot and wounded, others had their ears cut off, and some of the women were raped.
During the night between the 12 and the 13, a certain number of murders occurred in Potocari. The Potocari area was not designed to be a murder place, but all these murders were done in the effect to scare the population and make them, in fact, rush towards the buses and the trucks in order to be evacuated. On this, in the course of this transportation, as it was already said, there were checkpoints where the men were taken out, and in case some additional men were still, able to go up to the end, they were separated.
At around noon, buses and trucks began to arrive. Women, children, and elderly men were separated and boarded on buses. Separation and deportation was organized under the control of the Special Police and Bosnian Serb Army, with the help of members of the Dutch Battalion. The Bratunac Brigade was responsible for monitoring fuel disbursements to the buses and trucks. According to handwritten records regarding the issuing of fuel, at least 42 buses from various Bosnian Serb companies arrived in Potocari and were fueled up. General Ratko Mladic mingled among the crowd of women, children and elderly, reassuring them that nothing would happen to them. All of this occurred while nearby soldiers began their crimes in scattered spots just out of view of UN officials.
Ne bojte se ništa, samo polako, polako. Neka prvo idu žene i djeca. Doće 30 autobusa, prebacit ćemo vas prema kladnju. Odatle ste preći na teritoriju koju kontrolišu alijne snage. Samo bez panike i propustite malu djecu i žene. Nemojte da se neko dijete izgubi. Ne bojte se ništa, niko vam neće ništa uraditi.
Genocide is crime of state and state institutions and resources. On the first place, based on the monopoly of violence, it means army, police and paramilitary troops. Denying genocide in post-genocide times, denying genocide is strategy of state. Genocide is not event. Genocide is a process with three main phases. The first phase is pre-genocide, genocide and post-genocide.
This was not a spontaneous project, but considering the personnel, the routes, and the provision of buses and fuel, which was immensely scarce in eastern Bosnia at this time, fuel was liquid gold. It was a well-planned and efficiently executed operation, all carried out according to a precise schedule set for the transfer of the population. Men who tried to board buses to Kladanj were systematically expelled from the buses and led to the White House, where sporadic executions took place, and which was located just in front of the UN battalion base in Potocari. The UN drew up a list of men in the UN base to keep track of them. The men begged the UN official in vain not to surrender them to the waiting Serbs, but they were compelled to leave the UN base. They were crying. You know, men, you can imagine men crying in front of you, seeking assistance from you, assistance which you can't give. It had gone beyond my control.
The UN safe area was created for us, not for the Dutch or the UN. And so what the Dutch did, or the UN, they actually evicted the people from the UN, from the last remaining space of the UN safe area. They evicted them, they sent them out, and this all happened under two flags that were placed still, you know, standing on top of the tallest building there, the UN flag and the flag of the Netherlands. The people walked straight to their deaths, as you know, and the number of men and boys in Potocari, both inside and outside the compound, you know, summed up together, was about 2,000.
The Dutch deputy battalion commander had initially protested to the Bosnian Serb army about the separation of the men, but relented when the latter claimed that the men would not be harmed and would simply be treated as prisoners of war in accordance with the Geneva Conventions. When Major Robert Flanken, deputy commander of the Dutch battalion, was asked why the Serbs appropriated the UN vehicles, he answered, "Because they didn't want us to witness whatever would happen."
The way to battle the denial, and those in academia who innocently deny, claiming that genocide intent is difficult to prove, is to actually quote them what the perpetrators themselves were planning and openly talking among themselves long before 1995. Perpetrators-based research is the best strategy to counter genocide denial.
The first convoys to leave Potocari include a few men on the buses as part of a propaganda exercise. This was for the benefit of the Dutch troops and the Serb TV cameras, but these men were later separated at checkpoints. By July 12, Bosnian Serb forces had expelled approximately 25,000 people who had lived in the enclave. Amid an atmosphere of terror, women, children and the elderly were boarded onto overcrowded buses and transported across the front lines into territory controlled by the Army of the Republic of Bosnia and Herzegovina. UN Security Council Resolution 1004 demanded that the Bosnian Serb forces cease their offensive and withdraw from the safe area of Srebrenica immediately.
And in addition, there is the aspect of fear. If you add demonization to fear, you get the recipe for genocide and other crimes, crimes against humanity and war crimes. It was the fear and the demonization in Rwanda that led to the genocide. It was the demonization of Muslims in the former Yugoslavia, in particular, of Jews and Gypsies and homosexuals in Nazi Germany, that enabled people to be killed en masse. And you need those, I believe you need those two ingredients, but particularly the first one, the demonization, and that's common to all the situations of genocide.
The International Tribunal has established on the basis of evidence that more than 8,000 Muslims, men and boys, either civilians or prisoners of war, were killed in the course of a well-organized and planned operation that lasted less than a week and required significant logistical arrangements and resources. Soldiers needed to be mobilized to guard the prisoners and transferred from their positions to those of the execution sites to shoot the prisoners. A number of locations needed to be identified and secured for the detention and execution of the prisoners. Thousands and thousands of bullets needed to be provided for the executions. Ligatures and blindfolds needed to be prepared. Numerous vehicles and hundreds of liters of fuel needed to be requested to transport the prisoners. The judge found that far from being a flash of rage or revenge, it was deliberate and decided at the highest level.
I arrived in Tuzla 20 of June 1995, and just to be precise about the investigation is about the events that unfolded after the 11 July noon. So it's not an investigation about why airstrikes or no airstrikes, not an investigation on the takeover of the enclave, it's only about the criminal events that followed the fall of the enclave.
During the next 3 days, a column of 12,000 to 15,000 people progressed north. On July 13, groups that had broken off from the column made their way to the main road and finally managed to cross the road by dawn. The last large groups crossed the asphalt road around 6 a.m., at which point any further movement was impossible, as the Bosnian Serb army had placed a large force at the site. Groups of men in large numbers from the rear of the column began surrendering to the Bosnian Serb army. From the start of the day until 5:30 p.m., at least 6,000 men from the column were captured in different places on their way to Kladanj and sent to various detention areas. Witnesses estimated that between 1,000 and 4,000 people captured from the column were detained in Sandici Meadow. The soldiers guarding them demanded that they place their belongings in a pile and surrender their valuables.
Well, the most important aspect of this is, of course, again, the victims. They want a public acknowledgement, not only from their own people, in this case in Bosnia and Herzegovina, but they want the world to know what happened. They've received the acknowledgement through the evidence of hundreds of witnesses. What happened has been proven.
Between 1,500 and 3,000 people captured from the column were detained at a football field in Nova Kasaba and forced to surrender their belongings and valuables. A number of the prisoners held at Nova Kasaba and Konjevich Polje were executed during the morning of July 13 on the banks of the Jadar River, where they were lined up and shot. Thousands of the Bosnian Muslims taken captive after the fall of Srebrenica were killed in carefully planned mass executions starting on July 13. Mass executions at the sites further north of Bratunac were carried out between July 14 and July 17.
Richard Goldstone is small, he's not physically impressive, but without him I think that we couldn't have the case of genocide. It could be forsaken and forgotten, like genocide in Cambodia with 2 million killed, like genocide in Guatemala with 200,000 killed Maya people, the genocide in Argentina with 60,000 killed. Genocide happened in Rwanda in 94, and without such people, we cannot have the cases, and it could be forsaken and forgotten. It's not, and now we have possibility to talk, to try to understand what is post-genocide society where we live now today.
The corps and brigade commanders were ordered to intercept the column. They located a gathered mass of around 5,000 men from the column and opened artillery fire on them. Various levels at the UN were alarmed that violence had been inflicted against the men of Srebrenica. The UN Secretary General's special envoy was sent to continue with the renewal of negotiations with Bosnian Serb officials at the highest levels and, if deemed appropriate, with authorities in Belgrade. There were visible signs of the existence of a plan for mass executions. Entries in a travel log for a vehicle from the Zvornik Brigade Command showed that the same vehicle drove to various locations where, during the next few days, thousands of Bosnian Muslim men were detained.
Establishing the fact follows a kind of natural chronology. The first step is reconstructing the events through the interviews of the victims, the witnesses, but also at a later stage through the eyes of the perpetrators who also enter the interview process.
In the afternoon of July 13, systematic executions on a large scale began in Cerska. At around 4 p.m., the Bosnian Serb army drove buses carrying prisoners to Cerska and executed them. Late in the afternoon, more than 1,000 prisoners in Sandici village were taken to Kravica and detained in a warehouse. Executions began around 5 p.m. and lasted several hours. Prisoners were killed with infantry arms, machine guns and grenades. After the last prisoner was killed, an excavator began hauling the bodies out of the warehouse. The physical transfer of prisoners from temporary detention places in and around Bratunac to detention and execution sites within the area under the responsibility of the Zvornik Brigade represented the second phase of the process.
Then the second phase is to find the places the people are talking about, which is not necessarily very obvious. And all this has to be done in a hostile environment, in work conditions which are not usual in a normal environment.
Prisoners were kept in the old school in Bratunac from the late afternoon of July 13 until the afternoon of July 15 and during this period, they were given no food and only a small amount of water. Other prisoners who were captured on July 13 on the Konjevich-Polje-Bratunac road were kept in buses and trucks in the parking lot. This group of prisoners was first collected at Sandici Meadow. They were next loaded onto 5 to 6 tractor trailers with 20-ton loads. They were then taken to an unknown location in Bratunac, where they spent the night in trucks. In the morning, they were taken to the other end of town, where they waited several hours before they left Bratunac and arrived at the school in Petkovci. Soldiers of the Military Police Battalion, the 65th Protection Regiment of the Bosnian Serb Army, guarded the 1,500 to 3,000 prisoners held on the football field. Later that afternoon, they were taken to an unknown location in Bratunac. On July 14, they were taken by bus to a high school in the village of Pilica. Miroslav Deronic testified that at the beginning of July 1995, Radovan Karadzic told him, "Miroslav, they should all be killed. Kill all those that fall into your hands." 2 days after the fall of Srebrenica, Deronic told Radovan Karadzic by telephone that Bratunac housed a number of prisoners. Karadzic replied, "Someone will come soon with instructions on what to do with them." That night, the Bosnian Serb Army Chief of Security came to Deronic and told him that he had an order from the highest levels that all prisoners should be executed. "It was reported to me that on the evening of July 13, approximately 80 to 100 Bosnian Muslim men had been killed in a hangar at the school Vuk Karadzic in Bratunac."
After this, the other additional phase is to process these crime scenes by taking pictures, videos, documenting them, but also taking samples, process all these samples through labs, so that the what we call the technical and scientific police aspect of it.
All the piles of personal belongings of civilians deported from Potocari, including the identity papers of the men seized, were burned. At that point, soldiers from the Dutch battalion were sure that the story about screening for war criminals could not be true. In the absence of personal documents, these men could no longer be accurately identified for any purpose. Rather, the removal of their documents could only be an ominous signal of atrocities to come. Order I-1638 concerned the prevention of any leakage of classified military information regarding the performance of activities in this area. This order was sent to the Drina Corps Command. It ordered the closure of the roads except to military and police vehicles engaged in combat operations. General Major Radoslav Krstić was made commander of the Drina Corps. Bosnian Serb army officers often used unprotected lines because they were faster. The Army of the Republic of Bosnia and Herzegovina intelligence officers intercepted conversations over these lines. These recordings were later submitted to the prosecutor's office at the Hague Tribunal. The general ordered the major to take urgent measures to ensure that nothing gets through. Concern over the number of prisoners in and around the area of Bratunac soon became a topic of discussion among senior security and political figures in the area. Deronic was afraid the prisoners represented a threat to the city's security and did not want killings done in or around Bratunac. "At the meeting, we openly discussed the killing operations, that all prisoners be transported to Zvornik, where they would be detained and killed." Over the course of 3 days, July 11, 12 and 13, the entire Muslim population of the enclave had either fled or been deported or killed.
But more importantly, the genocide itself, mass killings, imprisonment, torture, and other related activities constituted the final climactic act in eliminating all non-Serb civilians from the enclave so that the Drina Valley was purely Serb land in political control and habitation.
Hawke said he had found 50 men in the forest and that we must kill them. The officer told him, "Surround them and kill them slowly."
Well, the attitude of any international prosecutor should be, and I think it has been, to investigate and bring out indictments against the most guilty. And the most guilty are the people, the leaders, whether political or military, the leaders who organized and aided and abetted in the perpetration of these massive crimes, and especially genocide and crimes against humanity.
The Bosnian Serb army mounted an ambush at Mount Veljeglava that broke the column. The column returned towards Mladenovac. It stopped at Jošanica Gaj and waited to regroup. After 16 hours, it continued moving again. In the area of Marčići Snagovo village, the Bosnian Serb army staged another ambush with a combination of tanks and APCs and the support of Ministry of Interior Special Forces. The column continued towards Tuzla. Reports of the disappearance of Bosnian Muslim men from Srebrenica began to appear in the world media.
But note that I said Bosnian genocide. The Srebrenica killings of July 1995 by themselves did indeed constitute a Srebrenica genocide. But I believe it is important to view what happened in and around Srebrenica at that time as the local climax of a genocide that was Bosnia-wide in scope and a product of a series of plans that originated with the republic-level leadership of the Bosnian Serb nationalists. That project as a whole, from its origins to its end and across the entire republic, was indeed the Bosnian genocide.
The Bosnian Serb army set in motion its systematic killings of thousands of Muslim prisoners. They began by transferring prisoners from Bratunac to various locations. During July 14, 2,000 to 2,500 men in a convoy of 30 buses were transported from Bratunac to Zvornik. They were held in the gymnasium of an elementary school in Grbavci near Orohovac, as well as in other schools. For the executions, two adjacent meadows were used. The men were lined up and shot in the back. Those who survived the initial gunfire were killed with an extra shot. Once one meadow was full of bodies, the executioners moved to the other. While the executions were in progress, earth-moving equipment was digging the graves. The UN Security Council was especially concerned about reports that up to 4,000 men and boys had been forcibly removed from the Srebrenica safe area and demanded that, in conformity with internationally recognized standards of conduct and international law, the Bosnian Serb party release them immediately. The Serb forces transported 1,500 to 2,000 prisoners to Petkovci and detained them in the hall of a primary school. Prisoners killed between the 14th and 17th of July were buried within 24 to 48 hours in mass graves in the immediate vicinity of the execution sites. In some cases, victims were forced to dig their own graves. In other cases, they were lined up and shot in the graves themselves.
Rat u Bosni počeo 92. aprilu sa jednim puzećim, da kažem, genocidom. I on je završio sa Srebrenicom kao, kako kažem, finalnim aktom genocida u Bosni I Hercegovini, na koji je reagovala međunarodna zajednica. I pred sudom u Hagu samo je Srebrenica kvalifikovana kao genocid.
Sometime after midnight on July 15, the Bosnian Serb army loaded prisoners who had been detained in the new school in Petkovci onto trucks and drove them to Petkovci Dam, where they were then executed. The Bosnian Serb army lined up and shot prisoners in groups of 5 to 10 men. After the firing stopped, the only two survivors crawled out of the pile of bodies to a hiding spot. On the morning of July 15, work began on mass burials in the fields of Orahovac and near the dam in Petkovci, where the killings had been carried out. Mr. Bilt briefed the gathering on the results of his meeting with Milosevic and Mladic the previous day. Aware of reports that grave human rights abuses might have been committed against the men and boys of Srebrenica, but unaware that mass and systematic executions had commenced, the senior international officials and Milosevic were joined by Mladic for a largely ceremonial meeting over lunch. This was followed by a meeting between the UN commander in Bosnia and Mladic to finalize the details. Around 8 a.m. on the morning of July 16, 1995, some parts of the 28th Division of the Army of the Republic of Bosnia and Herzegovina, in a joint action with artillery support from the 2nd Corps from Tuzla, attacked and breached Bosnian Serb army lines, joining the front of the column in the area of Baljkovica, where fierce battles were taking place between the Zvornik Brigade and the 2nd Corps of the Army of the Republic of Bosnia and Herzegovina. Some parts of the columns continued trying to break through into territory under the control of the Army of the Republic of Bosnia and Herzegovina. There are still 3,500 parcels that I have to distribute, and I have no solution. I'll see what I can do. The word parcel was used in this intercepted conversation to describe the prisoners from the Bosnian Muslim column, while distribute meant handing them over to the killing squads. Obrenović is really engaged to the maximum. This parcel has done the most to ruin us. And since this morning, we have been reporting on the number of people. Subsequently, on July 16, 1995, men from the Bratunac Brigade arrived to assist members of the 10th Sabotage Detachment with the executions on the Branjevo military farm. Buses with prisoners arrived between 1 and 2 p.m., and a group of soldiers from the Bratunac Brigade joined Dražen Erdemović's unit to assist with the shootings, which lasted from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m.
And again, the place was fully processed scientific police. There is no survivor on this spot. Without the testimony of Dražen Erdemović, we would never have known anything about this crime scene.
The Pilica Culture Center was in the zone of responsibility of the 1st Battalion of the Zvornik Brigade. On July 16, hundreds of Muslim prisoners were executed there. According to the testimony of Dražen Erdemović, the same soldiers from Bratunac who had arrived to assist with the Branjevo military farm shootings carried out the killings at the Pilica Culture Center. After the executions at the Branjevo military farm, the soldiers from the 10th Sabotage Detachment left for a cafe in Pilica. The sounds of the executions lasted for approximately 15 to 20 minutes, after which a soldier from Bratunac entered the cafe in Pilica to inform Erdemović and the others present that everything was over. Officer Rašić confirmed that he had finished the job. Krstić was told that they needed to continue working at full steam and that he needs to continue the work. Hello, it's Popovic, boss. Everything's okay. That job is done. Everything's okay. Everything has been brought to an end. No problems. The grade is A. Milenko Tomic, a driver for the transportation of the dead bodies from Pilica to the Branjevo military farm, testified. 2 days later, I went to the chief, Pantic, and complained and described what I'd been carrying. Pantic just told me, a job is a job, and gave me a new task. In the early morning on July 18, a group of 200 men surrendered to the Bosnian Serb army in the area between Nova Kasaba and Konjevic Polje. In the Planinci Balkovica region, the Bosnian Serb army found and executed 20 men and surrounded an additional 150 persons. The UNPROFOR commander said how essential it was that the International Committee of the Red Cross be granted immediate access to the men being detained and that freedom of movement to the enclaves be restored for UNPROFOR and UNHCR. Throughout the meeting, he maintained contact with Mr. Bildt, who was holding parallel negotiations with President Milosevic in Belgrade. Small groups of Bosnian Muslim men trying to escape the enclave were killed on location after capture by the Bosnian Serb forces.
Nevertheless, indeed, end of September, beginning of October, a massive process, as massive as the killing process itself, starts in order to take out most of the bodies of the mass graves, in order to hide them in remote valleys, where stuffed of landmines, no returnees, in order to hide them. And leaving inside the primary graves just a little amount of bodies, in order to, in case we would find them, make us believe that if the witnesses said the truth, we were tremendously exaggerating the numbers.
Among the evidence that the judges used to determine the number of those killed by Bosnian Serb forces were the mass graves where the victims were buried. Primary graves were those sites where the bodies of victims were immediately buried after execution. Bosnian Serb forces later dispersed the primary graves in an effort to conceal their crimes. Over a period of several weeks in September and October 1995, bodies were removed from primary graves and reburied in other locations or secondary graves.
We came to the conclusion, and the courts, both the ICTY and the International Court of Justice, have supported our decision that a decision to destroy a group of that size in an enclave, in a village of Srebrenica, constituted an act of genocide, and that the necessary intention was there.
By killing all the military-aged men, the Bosnian Serb forces effectively destroyed the community of the Bosnian Muslims in Srebrenica and eliminated all likelihood that it could ever re-establish itself in that territory. The chamber concludes that the intent to kill all the Bosnian Muslim men of military age in Srebrenica in July 1995, in part, the Bosnian Muslim group within the meaning of Article 4 of the ICTY statute and must therefore be qualified as genocide. The trial chamber has thus concluded that the prosecution has proven beyond all reasonable doubt that genocide, crimes against humanity, and violations of the laws or customs of war were perpetrated against the Bosnian Muslims at Srebrenica in July 1995.
The denial of genocide that exists today in Bosnia and Herzegovina casts a dark cloud over its future and prevents the reconciliation process.
Now 20 years after Srebrenica, we are, I'm sure, in this post-genocide time, with genocide as our as an important part of our identity, and genocide as social practice in the region.
Process in which the terror affect our identity, it is a process that happened after the genocide. That's what I used to call the symbolic enactment of genocide, or even the post-genocidal societies.
And if we are dealing with the study of genocide, we must admit that we have much more questions than answers. And we have to understand that we must stay, even if it's so difficult, with no answer to many of the questions. But as you say, we must raise the question, because if we don't raise them, we don't deal with the real subject of genocide.
Usually the objective of the genociders is to have a post-genocidal society that ratifies and legitimizes the model of identity created through the terror. It is logic that it will happen, but it is not automatic. It is not absolute. So the societies can confront this model, and this is part of the post-genocidal society, this creation of the ways of represent and narrate the past.
The past, as the American, as the famous writer L.P. Hartley once remarked, is a foreign country. They do things differently there. It's not possible to live in the past. We are all aware of that. However, we have to face it. But denial of the past is different. It lives in the present.
When you deny a genocide, you prepare the ground to a new one.
Naše obrazovanje ne obrazuje građane, ono ne uči đake da kritički misle, da misle svojom glavom. A mislim da kad bismo uveli učenje o Srebrenici u škole, da bi to upravo značilo kritičko savladavanje prošlosti, a samim tim i jedan sasvim drugčiji odnos prema sadašnjosti.
It's a great shame in my view and a disappointment to me that there has never been a Truth and Reconciliation Commission in the former Yugoslavia. As a South African, From my experience of the huge success of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa, the people and the victims in Bosnia and Herzegovina, in all the countries of the former Yugoslavia, would have benefited from forcing all people to quote Archbishop Desmond Tutu, to look at the monster in the eye.
In the Jewish case, we were victim, but the world recognized our genocide and admitted. And Germany, after some years of hesitation, really deal honestly with her past. Holocaust is studied in German high school in a correct way, in an honest way. This is what a society has to do to rebuild her democracy.
The main challenge in post-genocidal society is to confront with these objectives of the perpetrators, to confront the goal of the genocide, and trying to create other representations, other ways to narrate the past, other ways to understand the terror and the objectives of the terror, and other ways to understand our own identity.
Kada bismo učili danas o Srebrenici, to bi pod jedan značilo da smo mi napustili programe zbog kojih smo u rat ušli. Da, to bi značilo da smo mi napravili pravi zaokret, napravili ozbiljnu distancu i da smo sad sposobni da se s tim suočimo.
Svaki istoričar može dati istinit izveštaj onome što se dogodilo u prošlosti. Mi istoričari treba da vršimo svoju dužnost i naša se volja treba da univerzalizuje kao dobra volja čoveka. Svako ostalo može da živi prema etičkim i moralnim uzusima onog što treba da bude i šta treba da čini. Mi smo, kako to kaže Agnes Heller, ograničeni na jedno zajedništvo sa smrtnima sa kojima delimo život. Bunar naše prošlosti zaista je dubok. Naša odgovornost zaista je ogromna. Postoji jedna želja koju ne mogu poništiti druge želje, a to je da učestvujemo u odgovornosti našeg zajedništva. Mi možemo živjeti poštenim životom. Zašto to da ne pokušamo?